Hello everyone and welcome to the Captain's Video Blog. We are Wednesday, February the 1st, 2017. And we're already off to a way better start than yesterday, where I just restarted the recording of the video blog like 15 times. Yeah, it sounds about right, because I just kept saying Monday, January the 31st, despite the fact that it made no sense. You know, I had the paper for Raw right under my eyes, and on that paper at the top of the page I write Monday Night Raw, and underneath that I write down the date, so all spelled out. You know, I had Monday, January the 30th, and you know, it pretty much means that obviously the 31st cannot be a Monday. Yeah. You know, it doesn't take someone really clever to figure that out. And besides that, there's one thing that I always do during the video blog, which is letting my eyes wander around the room that I'm in. And in this kitchen, we've got two calendars. The first one is on the wall opposite to me, and the other one is on the wall to the left of me. And you know, if the one in front of me is a bit far, you know, I cannot exactly make out the days. Yeah, I guess. The one to my left is way closer, so I would look at it, you know, and I would notice that something's up, something doesn't fit my narrative. What could it be? So I would watch more intently, and then I would notice, fuck, the 31st is a Tuesday. So I would, you know, stop the recording, delete the video, and as soon as I would push the record button again, poof, here goes my sense of logic. Poof, here goes my short-term memory, and you know, like fucking clockwork, brain dead, Monday, January the 31st, So at one point I had to relocate to the bathroom where I eventually recorded the video blog, and on the first try, you know, Tuesday, and then I went for 25 minutes. I wasn't too satisfied with the length, but just before deleting the video, I had an epiphany. I was like, nah, if I record one more time, I'm gonna say Monday. Yeah, and at that point, I might as well quit. So, no, I let it like that, and, well, 25 minutes. Not really satisfied about that, but hey, what can you do? Besides that, Paris won against Rennes 4-0. Yeah, that was pretty insulting, because Rennes has been at peak Rennes this transfer season. If you don't know what that means, it means that not only, you know, did they lose some players, they lost three of their top players: Grosicki, Pedro Henrique, and Entep. Last summer they had only lost Ousmane Dembélé, which was already pretty damaging, but yeah, this time they lose pretty much, you know, the three real good players that they've got, and to replace them, they've recruited Amalfi Tano. Yeah, you know, there's, well, I mean, sometimes you just cannot do anything else but wonder what the fuck are they thinking about. At least they recruited Rice Mbolly, the heroic goalkeeper from Algeria, you know, at the 2014 World Cup. But you know, you also have Costil, who is really good in his own respect. So yeah, and really the last goal was really insulting. It was the cheekiest set piece ever, with Pastore, the 42 million injured man, who did a free kick to Ben Arfa, and everyone thought that Ben Arfa was fucking out offside, and no, he wasn't, and he could have fucked it up. He could have overshot it, could have, you know, just given it to the goalkeeper, but no, he scored. So yeah, Paris, Monaco, I'm not exactly sure who I want Marseille to face the least, you know. Monaco, sure, they haven't put their top team on the pitch, but I mean, the round of 16 is something else entirely. And the worst thing about that is that, like, 3 days before the round of 16, Marseille plays against Paris. So yeah, like, it's going to be real tough. So anyway, moving on to SmackDown Live, Talking Smack, and 205 Live, and all of that, you know, all of that crazy shit was in Corpus Christi. And, you know, yesterday I thought that Laredo was a shit crowd. Jesus Christ. Yeah, Corpus Christi, if you don't know, is one of the worst cities to have a TV show, at least for wrestling, for the WWE. Yeah, if you remember Chicago, know how lively it is, and especially for the cruiserweights. Well, you take that, you take, you just imagine its polar opposite, and you've got Corpus Christi. So yeah, the first thing we saw on SmackDown was the recap of the Royal Rumble just being rubbed in the face of AJ Styles. You know, a reminder of his defeat, and yeah, he wanted a one-on-one rematch for the WWE Championship, which is normal. You know, he should have that. And Commissioner Shane McMahon and General Manager Daniel Bryan were like, "Yeah, we'll see about that, I guess." But they announced who would be in the Elimination Chamber. So obviously Cena, Styles, but then some surprises like Corbin or Bray Wyatt. Oh, who'd have thought? The Miz and the Intercontinental Champion. Dean Ambrose, who just arrived there to be sure that he would be in the Elimination Chamber. Yeah, he wanted to be sure about that, because he seems really intent on becoming a dual champion, which is, you know, something that you should thrive for. So yeah, go for it. AJ Styles was a bit pissed to see the Lunatic Fringe in the same office as him, and well, Ambrose, you know, judged that they had some unfinished business, you know, the whole ladder match at TLC. Yeah, so now that James Ellsworth isn't going to intervene, what about they have this match again? And yeah, it's been booked. It was the main event. They booked the main event at the beginning of the show. Ooh, great. Yeah, Cena then was in the ring, and you know, he talked about how wrong he was. He wanted to apologize, which really doesn't make sense, because if you think about it, Cena bragged about himself, bragged about saying that AJ Styles couldn't beat him, and you know, he was right. AJ Styles hasn't been able to beat John Cena to retain the WWE Championship. Why the fuck do you think you're wrong? Yeah, I mean, AJ Styles to me is the top performer currently in the WWE, and maybe one of the very best of all time. But yet, you know, he lost, and I guess that it would prove Cena right, but Cena thinks that it proved him wrong. I'm not gonna argue with that. So he want, you know, he didn't want no celebration, no confetti and all that. He wanted a good old fight, so open challenge, not for the championship, because let's be honest, you know, the WWE Championship has a little bit more prestige than the US Championship. And who came out? The Wyatt family, only Wyatt and Orton, because, well, Luke Harper isn't exactly part of the family anymore. Bray Wyatt cut a promo about how it was more of the same, how he was going to win the WWE Championship in the Elimination Chamber, starting the era of the Wyatts. And Randy Orton just added a layer saying that he would end it, you know, the whole thing between him and Cena. So yeah, you know, he didn't care about if it was going to be at WrestleMania or before. No, he would end it. So yeah, he started, you know, walking down to the ring. Luke Harper just teleported in the ring next to Cena, and you know, seeing the occasion, seeing the opportunity, Shane O'Mac decided to seize it and turned all that, you know, all that nonsense into a tag match. So on one side, the Wyatt family, Wyatt and Orton, and on the other side, Luke Harper and John Cena. And you know, Luke Harper, he's really great at telling me his internal struggle, you know, between, you know, he was torn between still, you know, being under the control of Bray Wyatt, still being afraid, still respecting Bray Wyatt as the patriarch of the cult, and you know, just wanting to bash Randy Orton's brains in. So yeah, it led to some really interesting moments, some really good in-ring storytelling. I liked it a lot. But at the end of the day, you know, he still tried to do the Sister Abigail. It didn't work. He was thrown out of the ring, and John Cena ate the pin. Yeah. It was on an RKO, so yeah, Bray Wyatt doesn't look any stronger. But at least it's not Luke Harper who took the pin, so he doesn't look any weaker. And John Cena, nothing can hurt him. You know, at this point, yeah, it's just nothing can hurt John Cena. Randy Orton was on Talking Smack later. What did he talk about? He talked about the fact that Luke Harper, you know, he's dangerous. Bray Wyatt gives him chance after chance after chance, but Randy Orton doesn't think that he still belongs in the Wyatt family. So yeah, but really, Randy doesn't sound a lot like a Wyatt. You know, he talked about his family being ringside, so his wife and his kids. When you think that he would have pushed them away, being in the Wyatt family and all that, but nah. And well, interestingly enough, AJ Styles is probably not getting his one-on-one rematch before the Elimination Chamber, because next week John Cena is facing none other than Randy Orton. So yeah. So speaking of James Ellsworth, he was he looked like someone who would say, "How you doing, fellow kids?" Yeah, I know that he's only like 30 years old, but I mean, it doesn't work. Yeah, that look on him doesn't work. So he sang the praises of Carmella, who was going to face Delilah Dawson, who had blue hair and, you know, a kind of uncommon ring attire. And you know what that means? It means that JBL ragged on her for the whole entire fucking match. Little interference from Ellsworth, and Carmella won with the code of silence. Yeah, nothing else to say about that. Then Kalisto versus Dolph Ziggler. Kalisto was pissed, got most of the offense, but then Dolph Ziggler had his new weapon, the fucking super kick. Yeah, super kick right under the chin of Kalisto. 1, 2, 3, he's got the win. He wanted to go, you know, all the way, so he tried to unmask Kalisto until, you know, he tried to do that, like, really, he put all his might, all his will into it until Apollo Crews arrived. And boy, Apollo Crews, you've got a lot of muscle, maybe too much to just go over the barricade, I guess, because, you know, he tried to go over the barricade, and I don't know if it was planned or not, but just Dolph Ziggler stood there for like 30 seconds before dashing away, because he saw that, you know, Crews wasn't just going to get over that. So yeah, Becky Lynch considers then that being attacked from the past is just like being attacked from every other side. She didn't forget about Mickie James' legacy, so yeah. Tonight she's teaming up with Naomi, who apparently was the one to get the pin on Alexa Bliss. And, well, the tag match was Naomi and Becky Lynch versus Alexa Bliss and Mickie James. And Mickie James, well, I mean, it was fairly obvious that she hadn't lost anything, because we've seen that in Toronto, and we've seen that in her run in TNA. But yeah, for WWE-centric fans, I guess that they really would have chanted, "You still got it," or something like that, which is entirely dumb, you know, incredibly stupid. So yeah, but despite how good everyone looked in the match, you know, when it comes down to it, Naomi still got the pin over Alexa Bliss after a split-legged moonsault. Holy shit, she's probably due for a title match. And guess what? When she went on Talking Smack, you know, she explained what feeling the glow was. She wanted people to feel the glow, you know, to realize themselves, to have fun, to really find themselves. And Naomi, you know, when she feels the glow, she feels like she wants to revitalize her career when the female division is probably at its top. So yeah, what did she get? She got a shot at the women's title at Elimination Chamber, and apparently she's been dreaming about entering WrestleMania with the title. She dreams so hard that her Uso needs to wake her up in the middle of the night. But Daniel Bryan was pretty worried about one thing, and it's something that I didn't think about until now. Naomi, when she enters, now she dances, but with, you know, at WrestleMania, is she going to be able to dance all the way down to the ring? Because it's a long ramp. Yeah, that's one legitimate concern, I think. Next, American Alpha. You know, they were a bit, you know, a bit pissed that nobody challenged them. You know, with Chad Gable almost knocking out Jason Jordan with his impersonation of somebody blind, because he had his title on one hand, so he just was spinning it around. So yeah, what did they do? They announced a little open challenge, and yeah, that open challenge didn't really happen because, well, it just was all the teams going at it, and at the end of all that brawl, only two teams were standing up: American Alpha and Slater and Rhino. So what happened on Talking Smack, where American Alpha were the first guests? Well, tag team turmoil at Elimination Chamber for the tag championships. Chad Gable seems very confident, maybe too confident, because he wants the team to enter first. Which, I mean, it's, yeah, sure, why not? But, yeah, just to think about it a little bit more. You don't want to lose your titles on a technicality, because that's very much what might happen. You know, it's a gauntlet. So, at one point, well, you just get caught in the moment, and, oh, it's a roll-up, fuck. Yeah. What else was there? Nikki Bella and Natalia barged into Daniel Bryan's office, with Natalia having her own security, started bickering with each other, until Daniel Bryan just had to yell enough. So what did he decide to settle things for the both of them? A match at Elimination Chamber. Whoa, the card is looking pretty good right now, I gotta say. Yeah, then it was Dean Ambrose versus AJ Styles, with Styles, you know, still being announced as the face that runs the place, despite the fact that he doesn't run anything anymore. Miz is on commentary. He's bickering with Otunga because, you know, he's the A-lister. Oh, you're a knockoff version of me and my wife. Blah 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 blah. Miz is instantly triggered when you mention Daniel Bryan. Holy shit. At one point it was going to the outside, the match, because it was an amazing match. I gotta say that it was a great match. I'm always pissed when of course, subject to change, we might as well book the main event when the show has already started. But nah, I mean, you gotta just recognize that AJ Styles and Dean Ambrose are among the top workers in the WWE right now, with AJ Styles just being up there, you know, with the greatest of all time. So yeah, it was a great match, an amazing match. The action picked up, but yeah, at one point, Jesus, it was going to the outside. Baron Corbin arrived. What? He just went on commentary to get just verbally buried by The Miz. He couldn't say anything, and it was frustrating him so much that he actually had to go and knock The Miz out, which actually prevented Dean Ambrose from winning. He did an elbow drop from the top turnbuckle. He had AJ Styles down for the count of three, but the referee was too distracted with The Miz holding on to the bottom rope, not to get beaten up by Baron Corbin. So, you know, tope suicida on Corbin from Ambrose, just a little throw in the barricade for The Miz. He goes back in, and Styles clash, Dean Ambrose loses. Yep, AJ Styles just dashed out of the ring. The Miz did the skull crushing finale on Ambrose, obviously. Then Corbin arrived, end of days on The Miz, end of days on Ambrose. So yeah, I think that he's ready. You know, unlike what Miz says, I think that Corbin is ready to step inside the Elimination Chamber. However, I think that he shouldn't probably do the end of days on the steel grates. Probably, you know, limit that to the deep six.
Yeah,
because there's been actually a lot of ovens that if they do that on the steel grates that are around the ring in the chamber, that might hurt like this back slam. Oh, ah, ugh. So yeah, pretty good episode of SmackDown. You know, well structured. The card for Elimination Chamber looks pretty stacked. The matches next week will, you know, probably feel like they're gonna lead up to something. Well, you know, just building some hype for the pay-per-view, which is, you know, not something easy to do when you've got only 2 weeks to do that and no card beforehand. So yeah, moving on to 205 Live, where god damn it, they really put Gentleman in Jack Gallagher's name. God fuck. And as it turns out, Roadblock and Divine was also last Sunday at the same time as the Royal Rumble, and at the same time as he won the Cruiserweight Championship. It was the time where Neville returned to the WWE. Yeah, that doesn't make sense. Nah, they probably just fucked up during the video package. So the first match was Tony Nese versus Lince Dorado with a dead crowd. Oh, that's always great. The head scissors take down from Lince Dorado from the top rope. That was one thing for the ages. Like, sure, Tony Nese, he's very strong, he's very athletic. Like, he forced Mauro Ranallo to do a Kazuchika Okada name drop with the hate to which both guys can go. Yeah, the palm strike on the top turnbuckle, the drop kick all the way to over the top turnbuckle. Yeah, suddenly you've got Cesaro and Kazuchika Okada being name dropped for their vertical abilities in the same sentence. What? Tony Nese won with the running knee. Apparently it's the running knees, which sounds pretty dumb actually, Austin Aries. So yeah, he put some more hurt on the Golden Lynx until TJP arrived. So yeah, first main event tier program for the Premier Athlete, Tony Nese versus TJ Perkins. That's going to be pretty damn amazing. Yeah. So Rich Swann is injured, despite being the one who was the last man standing at the end of the whole thing on Raw. Yeah, probably the adrenaline kept him moving. You know, Neville was like, he pushed. He pushed Swan, just the lack of respect, it's pretty amazing. Grand Metalik is debuting soon, but the first debut tonight was Akira Tozawa versus Aaron Solo, with Tozawa winning with the bridging snap German suplex, but that doesn't mean that Solo didn't have any offense, it just didn't, you know, it just wasn't enough. Noam Dar, you know, tried to suck it up to the King, which really never works, and, I mean, Neville is not one for teamwork, apparently, because, well, he was like, you know, as long as you listen to me, I'm okay with that, but you leave the baggage to the back, the baggage being Alicia Fox. So, yeah, for the last match, the main event, Neville and Noam Dar versus Jack Gallagher and Cedric Alexander, with a stark, you know, the stark difference between Northeastern and Northwestern England, the Scouser versus the Geordie, yeah, the Gentleman versus the King. I guess. The drop kick at the back of Gallagher's head was nasty. Like, he's gonna remember that when his neck gets feud, if I want to, you know, do a little reference to the match between Okada and Omega, because that was, that was as nasty, actually. Neville left Noam Dar high and dry, because Noam Dar at one point he hot tagged himself into the match, and yet after that he just tagged himself out, and then, you know, he was allowed to tag himself in again, and he just wasn't, you know, doing anything great. So yeah, Neville was like, yeah, I had a chance, you screwed it, goodbye. And Noam Dar lost with the lumbar check. Yep. Nothing else to say, you know, for the most exciting hour on TV. It's pretty sad that it's neither that exciting nor on TV. It sounds like a bit like a false advertising. But yeah, still three pretty good matches. Yeah, I'm excited to see where Tony Nese versus TJ Perkins goes. We'll see if Rizwan is back before WrestleMania, or at least before Fastlane. And yeah, we'll see about that. Thanks for watching. See you tomorrow. Bye. We'll talk about NXT and maybe other stuff. We'll see.